Hi, welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today's topic is meningitis. Remember that the meninges are the lining that covers the brain, the protective layer. So when we have inflammation or itis there, it might cause some neurological symptoms in the patient. So let's look at this. So meningitis is the most common central nervous system infection, and it can be caused by viruses or bacteria. So examples of viruses would be mumps, herpes, or enterovirus. So really any virus can travel in the bloodstream and then cause meningitis. Bacterial would be HIB, so Haemophilus influenza type B. That's also the cause for epiglottitis in children. Strep pneumonia, tuberculosis, and Neisseria meningitis. These are all primary causes of meningitis. So this is directly related to these viruses or bacteria. Now, secondary causes of meningitis is basically has to do with somehow an intrusion to the central nervous system. And that could be due to neurosurgery. So somebody who might have a tumor or an aneurysm that needs repair, some sort of head trauma. Systemic infections can travel and affect the meninges, as well as infections of the head, ears, eyes, nose, and throat, so the HEENT system, because they're so close to the brain, so they can spread easily, causing inflammation of the meninges. So signs and symptoms, I've delineated here for the pediatric as well as the adult population. So in neonates, when they have neurological symptoms, they might have poor feeding and sucking. Therefore, they're not gonna develop the way that they should. They might be irritable, but they might also be lethargic. So there's a wide spectrum here. They might have some vomiting and diarrhea. They might have seizures because the central nervous system is so irritated. They might be hypo or hyperthermic, so increase or decrease in temperature. And they might have bulging fontanelles, which is always a sign of increased intracranial pressure. And as with any inflammation, inflammatory markers are gonna travel to the site. And therefore in neonates, when the fontanelle is still open, we might see that bulging there. So that's always a warning sign that there's something going on with the brain or the central nervous system. Now in children or adults, they might be complaining of a headache, and that is usually a pretty significant severity in the headache. They might have photophobia, so sensitivity to light. They might also have increased intracranial pressure. And then they might have nuchal rigidity, which basically means neck stiffness. And there are two signs that are named after Mr. Koenig and Mr. Brodzinski that we can assess for here in terms of this neck stiffness. So Koenig's sign is resistance to the extension of the legs with hip or knee flexion. So that is basically when we're holding the patient's leg in a flexed position and we're trying to extend it, we're trying to straighten it, and that causes irritation through the spinal canal all the way up to the central nervous system and the brain, and the patient will resist because it makes that headache and that intracranial pressure worse. Now, Brodzinski's sign is passive neck flexion causes the hips and knees to flex. So you would go to the patient, you will ask him to relax, you would passively move their head down, the chin down to the chest, and because again this causes an increase in the pressure here in the central nervous system and the spinal canal, they will passively bend their hips, flex at the hips and knees. So those two signs are telltale that there's nuchal rigidity or neck stiffness, which is a telltale sign for meningitis. Patient clearly, whenever there's inflammation or infection, one might have a fever. Just like in neonates, patients might have vomiting or diarrhea. They might be agitated, they might be lethargic, they might be very irritable and have altered level of consciousness. And if there's meningococcal infection, so if that's the cause, then the patient might also have petechiae and purpura, which is basically a leakage of the blood vessels that are underneath the skin, and petechiae are basically tiny little red dots that we can see that are leaking underneath the patient's skin. So it's not actively bleeding, but we can just see these spots of blood, of discoloration underneath the skin. And then purpura are basically petechiae that are exaggerated. So there's multiple petechiae now together, and the patient will have big blotches of this purpura. And these signs are telltale of meningitis. If you see that this patient is critically ill, they probably are very altered, and they need to be admitted to the intensive care, and the likelihood that something bad is going to happen from there on, that they might not recover completely, is very high. So petechiae and purpura, if you haven't seen or encountered that, I encourage you to Google search and see what that looks like so that you are aware. Now, how do we diagnose meningitis? So of course, if there's a suspicion with any of these signs and symptoms, and maybe a history of any of these infections or traumatic interventions to the brain, we need to do a lumbar puncture, which is also called a spinal tap, and send that cerebral spinal fluid to the lab for analysis. Now, because this is a significant infection, we're also going to want to draw some blood cultures to see if this has spread systemically or where the infection might come from, and also what the causative organism is. And we might also do a nose or throat culture if there is a suspicion that it might come from the upper respiratory system, this infection that has spread. Now, over here, for lumbar puncture, and we'll go over the care for a patient during the procedure, but the CSF, once the provider or the physician inserts that needle, and it's a consistency that's kind of not quite as liquid or as viscous as water. So it's a little bit thicker than that, but not quite as like a gel. So once that fluid is retrieved from the patient's lumbar spine, we can look at that. And so there will be differences whether it's viral or bacterial in cause. So when it's viral, it will be clear. That fluid will be clear. The white count, when we get the results back from the lab, will be extremely, extremely elevated. Protein levels might be slightly increased or normal, and glucose levels will be normal. So those are some things that we'll see on the CSF analysis. Now, in contrast, bacterial, remember, whenever there's a bacterial infection, the fluid will be cloudy. So think about any kind of infection, really. Sinus infection, the nasal congestion will be cloudy or more yellow and greenish. If you have a wound infection and that's now draining, it will be kind of turbid, malodorous, and very cloudy. So that always is a telltale sign for bacterial infection, no matter where we get the analysis from. But for CSF, so as soon as that cerebral spinal fluid is retrieved from the patient's spinal canal, we will see that it's cloudy, but also the lab report will tell us about that. White count might be mildly increased, and protein levels will be extremely increased, and glucose levels will be decreased. And the reason is bacteria, as we know, love a warm, dark, sugary environment. They love to replicate there. So they eat up all the glucose, and in turn, they produce proteins. So that's why the glucose level in bacterial meningitis of the cerebral spinal fluid is decreased, the protein level is up, and there's a mild elevation in white count. So these are usually things that could come up on an exam too, so I encourage you to memorize this small table down here. Complications from meningitis. In infants or children, it can be hydrocephalus, so increase in intracranial pressure that might persist for some time. There might be permanent or temporary vision or hearing loss. So again, because it's the lining of the brain, or it might, the infection might have come from the ears or sinuses, so that can be a complication, as well as delayed growth. So now there's a central nervous system infection in a very small child that can certainly lead to their delayed growth and development. Because of the irritation of the meninges, patient might be prone to seizures, and that is during as well as after the infection is over. There might be cranial nerve palsy, again, because it is an infection of the central nervous system, and that might affect any cranial nerve. So whatever cranial nerve you can think of and its function, it might not be functioning normally. So this might be impaired swallowing, it might be a droopy eyelid, it might be facial droop, it might be impaired vision, impaired hearing. So all these functions that the cranial nerves take care of. Certainly, when the patient has these significant findings of petechia purpura, they're at high risk of death. And if they recover from the meningitis, they might be suffering from a headache for weeks or sometimes months after the infection. Now, for treatment, if it's bacterial, we want to isolate the patient because this is highly contagious. And the patient will be placed in a private room on droplet precautions until 24 hours after the antibiotics are started. But for the most part, hospitals will keep the patient isolated for maybe even the duration of their stay. They will certainly require IV antibiotics because we're dealing with a bacterial infection, and certainly they're going to need IV fluids for hydration, because if they have altered mental status and they don't want to eat, then we need to make sure we keep them hydrated by intravenous means. When the patient is really sick, they might need ICU admission. And so in bacterial, meningitis is very, very serious. Now, viral meningitis is usually just treated by supportive care. This can be done, managed as an outpatient, and you would treat that like any other viral infection by rest, taking over-the-counter anti-inflammatories, hydrating, treating the fever with antipyretics as needed, having a healthy nutrition, all those good things that we educate our patients on. Now, nursing care, for when the patient is admitted, because of that irritation of the central nervous system, we want to make sure we decrease environmental stimuli, as well as we're going to be in charge of the administration of IV antibiotics and fluids. And then we're going to do frequent neuroassessments to see how the patient is progressing. Are they getting better or worse? Because clearly we always worry about their airway maintenance if they are altered. So if they're getting worse, they might not be able to maintain their airway and they might require mechanical ventilation. So the care during, the nursing care during the lumbar puncture, what the goal is here is to assist the provider in, number one, the sterile procedure, and then number two, to position the patient so that the procedure can be as atraumatic as possible. And because it is a sterile procedure, everybody present in the room will need to be wearing a mask, because we don't want to be coughing or breathing on the insertion site of that needle, because it will be in the lumbar spine. And so we can introduce bacteria or any kind of organism really through that needle if we're not extra cautious. And the easiest way to position the patient, so depending on their age, if it's a neonate, we'll basically put them in the fetal position. We will curl them up as much as possible, knees to the chest and then chin to the chest. So basically curl them up so the space between the vertebra will open up and it'll be easier for the provider to get that needle in there in just the right space to obtain that cerebral spinal fluid. If there's an adult or cooperating child, we can ask the patient to sit on the side of the bed and support themselves over the overbite table, which is basically very similar to opening that lumbar spine space. We talked about sterile procedures. Certainly, we need to send the CSF to the lab for analysis. And afterwards, we need to keep the patient flat for an hour or two, because if the patient moves around and changes their position too soon after the procedure, they might have a spinal headache, and that spinal headache can last for several days and is usually pretty significant. And so if the patient is already having headaches and neurological symptoms, we do not want to give them a headache on top of that from the procedure. Now, keeping them flat might not be possible for small children that are more active and don't really understand the explanation that we would give them for this. So small or younger children, they can play quietly as long as they don't get too excited and start, you know, walking and playing kind of wildly and walking around the room. So keep in mind, meningitis is very, very serious. Any of these signs and symptoms can lead to death, really, if it's not acknowledged and treated properly. And remember that we do have vaccinations to treat meningitis, and that's usually given once the patient reaches adolescence, because in dorms and crowded conditions, there have been some outbreaks lately that have been pretty significant. So vaccination would be number one priority to prevent meningitis. So thank you for watching this video on meningitis. I hope you've enjoyed it and it helped you gain a better understanding. Please follow me on YouTube and subscribe, and also check out my Instagram page to get the latest posting of videos and any announcements. Thanks for watching. See you next time.